All right, everyone, we're going to get this show going on the road right now. If any of you don't know, my name is Nate Young. I'm president of the College Republicans, and I'd like to welcome everyone for coming tonight on Valentine's Day. I know it might have been a little bit of an issue, but thank you all for coming. So tonight, the College Republicans are pleased to welcome Dr. Thomas Mace. Dr. Thomas Mace grew up in Menasha and graduated from Ripon College in 1969 with a degree in psychology. While at Ripon, he was a member of the Phi Delta Theta, lettered in wrestling, and was active in the Young Republicans. He and David Sinish also built a ski hill on campus, which I'll have to have you explain later on. And then after graduation, he joined the U.S. Air Force and became a KC-135 tanker pilot, serving on nuclear alert and in Vietnam. He left the Air Force in 1974 to enter graduate school in Madison, earning the MS and PhD degrees in environmental monitoring, the first degree granted by the university in environmental monitoring. Between master's and doctorate studies, he spent a year in Mexico working for Spectral Data Corporation, identifying opium poppy fields from aerial photography. After receiving his doctorate in 1980, he was hired by Lockheed under contract to the US EPA and its Environmental Monitoring Systems Laboratory in Las Vegas. He held a series of positions beginning with senior scientist and ending with remote sensing department manager. He transitioned to EPA in 1986 as chief remote and air monitoring research branch. While in EPA, he held various positions as scientist and manager at Las Vegas, Washington, D.C., and Research Triangle Park, North Carolina. While in these roles, he successfully championed the use of geographic information systems in EPA, served as the EPA liaison to NASA for the mission to Planet Earth, and chaired the Interagency Working Group on Data Management for Global Change. He also served on a team assisting Latvia, Estonia, Lithuania, and Slovakia to develop environmental monitoring solutions upon their departure from the Soviet Union. In 2000, he transitioned to NASA at the Armstrong Flight Research Center on Edwards Air Force Base, California, where he served in a number of roles, including director, airborne science directorate, acting director, test systems directorate, and senior science advisor. Prior to his retirement from NASA at the end of 2012, he served on the NASA Climate Adaptation Science Investigator Team, looking at the vulnerabilities and sustaining adaptations to climate change for NASA facilities throughout 2080. He currently is the owner and operator of Mace Geospatial LLC, assisting NASA and NOAA with remote sensing and GIS research and evaluations. He has 4 children and 4 grandchildren, is married to Judge Nancy Krieger and lives in Menasha, and he considers himself both a conservative and a conservationist. Give it up to Dr. Thomas Mace.
That's okay. Okay, well, wow, I expected just a few, and it's a full room. Thanks for coming. Happy Valentine's Day to all of you. So how did I get to be a conservative and a conservationist? As you're all well aware, the Republican Party's exactly all in lockstep, at least with respect to climate change and with a whole lot of environmental issues as well. Well, really, I got there about the same way as this guy. If you have not read a Sand County Almanac, do so. Although Leopold started out as a hunter and a fisherman, which is basically how I started out, and became one of the pioneers of environmental and ecosystems protection. He has a little cabin that's north of Madison that you can visit. It's really a wonderful place, and I highly recommend this book to you. Well, let me back up a little bit. I grew up in Menasha, on the lake, actually on a little backwater area that had a wetland right across the water from our house. And my friend and I, Eric Forsgren, who's also a Ripon grad, he's now a lawyer over in brought home from a poigan 2 bucket loads of leopard frogs for the purpose of using them for bait. My mother didn't like the idea very well. So she said, you dump those things. So Eric and I took these 2 buckets and dumped them in the water, and off they swam. Well, the next year, the racket from leopard frogs was, you could almost not hear yourself, And we kind of noticed the mosquito population wasn't quite as bad as it actually was. Year after that, the black bass, largemouth, moved in, and we had great fishing. A couple of years later, a developer filled in the wetland in the wintertime when they were hibernating. And the year after that, the black bass were gone. So at about age 8 or 9, I had my first lesson in ecosystems, and what it means to protect them, and why we as hunters and fishermen should hang on to those ecosystems, and that they provide services to us. Okay, so let's flash a little bit further forward. Like Aldo Leopold, I went to high school in the West, and learned to rope and ride cattle and do rodeo stuff. It was just really wonderful. But I also gained an appreciation for the desert. And in fact, there's another book that he's written is about the desert Southwest. That is just almost as good as this one. Came back, went to Ripon. Was here as the introduction said, between 65 and 69. I graduated, and of course you had 4 choices when you graduated: Army, Navy, Air Force, or Marines. There were 500,000 guys over in Vietnam, and the Oshkosh Draft Board took college graduates first. My parents had both been flight instructors. In fact, they operated Ripon Airport in the late 40s. Which isn't there anymore. There was a grass strip up next to the highway on the way to Oshkosh. So I thought flying was probably the best thing. And so I entered the Air Force. I picked a tanker because it was a 707. I was going to go in the airlines. Well, just to show you can't always predict what's going to happen, the Arabs had just cut off the oil in 74 when I got out, and there were no airline jobs, so I went back to Madison. But an interesting part of the journey was looking out the window of my airplane as I flew all over the world, really, and seeing all kinds of environmental damage. And so when I went to Madison, I was interested in this stuff called remote sensing, which is the use of cameras and other sensors to do Earth observations. From there, went, as he pointed out, to Mexico for a little bit. We identified the poppies and then went out with helicopters and sprayed them. It was kind of an interesting interlude between master's and PhD. And then I came back here for a little bit and finished the PhD, was hired by Lockheed, and he went through the sort of litany. So I spent about 20 years almost working with the Environmental Protection Agency and championing the use of environmental monitoring within the bag of tricks of this regular agency, but I was in research. Then a friend of mine called me up and said he was retiring and needed a deputy out in NASA, and this was this time I spent in airborne science, and I considered that to be really a magical time. We flew all over the world with the DC-8 and U-2s, and eventually we ended up with Global Hawks and Predator and a Gulfstream and a whole bunch of other airplanes for Earth observations. And scientists would compete to come on the airplane. Maybe out of 300 proposals, we'd select 15. And they'd come on the airplane, we'd integrate everything in, then fly off to someplace. So I managed to fly over both poles, into hurricanes, looking at volcanoes. It was just really a magical time. But in addition to the work I had done with EPA on climate change, looking at data, it gave me a chance to be with the top scientists in the country while they were making these measurements, largely for global change. So if I hit hard on data, that's why. First of all, I'm not a modeler, I'm a monitor, and I really feel very strongly that we need to use data in decisions instead of talking heads. So what does some of that look like? All right. Can you see that?
No.
Well enough? Can we
no.
maybe dim the lights?
Yeah.
The x-axis here is time going back 400,000 years. Now these are measurements. This isn't somebody's model or somebody's guess or somebody's opinion. The recent ones where it says current level, and I'll show you that in just a minute, are from observations at the Mauna Loa Observatory of CO2 levels over the last 50 years. The prior record is gained through chemical analysis of bubbles in core samples from ice. So these are real, honest goodness data. And yes, indeed, it's very cyclical. Except, we should be in a decline now, and we're not. Looking at the upper part of that curve that looked more or less vertical in that chart because of the time frame, we look back at the observatory. Yes, we have cycles. Those little squiggles are the northern hemisphere greening up every year, pulling more CO2 out of the atmosphere. And then winter comes, and it climbs, and each year climbs above the last. And now we're over 400 parts per million. Again, these are the data. I had the privilege of flying out of Thule, Greenland, which is up here. And we flew over the Jakobshavn Glacier, which is about there, in the springtime. And Jakobshavn is the fastest moving glacier in the world. It moves 20 meters a day. It calved in a 6-day repeat cycle. We used our radar and we measured it. Almost 900 meters back in 6 days. That's dumping a lot of ice in the water. And the glaciers in eastern Greenland are similar. Again, these are measurements. The other thing you can see with your eye is the fact that the Northwest Passage exists now. This is shrinking. This is the ice mass, and you could sail a ship all the way through there, or you can sail it across there. That hadn't happened before. There are all kinds of, you can read all kinds of expeditions, tried to make the Northwest Passage and got frozen in the ice, and they're interesting read, but ultimately the predictions are that will go away. We won't have any ice at the end of September. Now it has a lot of implications. But again, this is a composite of satellite images from late in the fall. And every year, there's a little bit more water. It has some interesting effects. And this is not measurement, but a theory. The sum of the weather that we're experiencing is due to the fact that open water being black is absorbing a lot more energy. But absorbs, it has to re-radiate. Simple physics. And it's creating eddying effects in the polar vortex that cause these loops in the jet stream that changes the weather. That's a current explanation of the data rather than, you know, our data by itself, but it's fairly plausible. And it isn't always just about these guys. I figured Valentine's Day, this was a bit we are in a period now, there's a book out called The Sixth Extinction. There have been five in Earth history. And several authors are saying, well, the rate of extinctions now are so much greater than normal that we may be in the sixth extinction. The Earth doesn't care. The Earth is pretty much going to be a blue marble a million years from now. Whether people are here or not is quite another matter. More data. Where does the CO2 of the atmosphere go? A lot of it goes in the ocean. And as it passes the water-air interface, it forms carbonic acid. Chemistry. And you can see the measurements of both pH and carbon dioxide levels. Carbon dioxide is increasing on your left as you face it, and pH is going down. It's about 30% more acidified now. That's causing coral leaching. And the potential for reduction in large populations in the ocean due to ecosystem damage. And global change isn't always just about climate. We are doing many things. This is Las Vegas in two different time frames, and you can actually, that was why probably part of the time I was living there. The population on the planet is exploding, creating competition for natural resources. So we have things interacting. It isn't just the climate changing. It's a whole constellation of things that are happening all at once. And now that we have observation systems, when 1972, when the Landsat satellite was first launched, there were only a couple of observation satellites. Now NASA has over 26 of them, all with multiple sensors on them. We're receiving huge amounts of data on the planet, which is why our thinking has evolved from when I was at Wisconsin in the 70s, there was even talk about global cooling. But during the 80s, we realized things like the ozone hole were real, and we made measurements of them. Through the 90s, were the great number of these satellites were launched. The Mission to Planet Earth, or the Earth Observing System, as it's called now, has added to our knowledge. We have a tremendous gain in measurement technologies that have basically changed the view of whether climate change is real, how extensive is it, and so forth. It's very hard for somebody to get out and say the planet is cooling. The data just don't say that. One of the things we did in NASA, and by the way, what I want to do, I've only got one or two more slides, is stop lecturing and talk to with all of you, because I think that's the best way to explore subjects which are sometimes controversial. Let me just go through this and the next one, and then we'll open it up. NASA has 10 centers, and they all have vulnerabilities, and this is a vulnerability chart. It's kind of an eye chart for you there, but on the right are disease and air pollution and heat waves and sea level rise. One of the easy ones to imagine is sea level rise and increased storm intensity, and the $2 billion worth of infrastructure we have on a barrier island very real. NASA has to deal with that. It's a lot of money. And as a conservative, I kind of like to see the money be properly allocated and properly used. And when we have facilities that are at risk, we have to do something about that. I mean, it's a combination of climate science and civil engineering. One of the things that we had, and this is kind of the last one, some things you don't even think about. Coccidioidomycosis is more commonly called valley fever. And this is data, again, from the LA County Health Department. The organism is a spore. It's a fungal spore. And it just turns out it's more resistant to heat than the other microorganisms in the desert soil. So that if you get into a climate which is progressively drier, interspersed with more severe storms, you've created a condition where this organism thrives and the others don't. That's its ecological niche. Well, we're already seeing it because of development. You stir up the soil and more people get exposed. So we're just at the beginning of looking at things like this. That are diseases, human diseases, that are the result of climate conditions that have changed over time. And there's just one last slide here. There we go. Okay. What can we do about it? And this is kind of where I loop back to what are conservative ideas. There's been a lot of talk about cap and trade, put a ceiling on the amount of carbon released into the atmosphere. And if you don't use all of your credits, you can sell them back and forth. It's been fairly unsuccessful. Another possible idea is called fee and dividend. And it's being promoted by a climate lobby group. And basically what it means is you charge for the damage caused by carbon, and then you reinvest it back into the people. It's very much like what they do with the oil royalties in Alaska. So it's revenue neutral, which is a nice term for Washington. People like that. Other options are regulations, or do we need special international agreements? What about Kyoto? You know, what about Paris Agreement? We basically fixed the ozone hole problem with the Montreal Protocol. Is there something similar? And I'm going to leave it there and kind of open it up. Because this is really intended to be a dialogue. So, who wants to go first?
What is the effect on the NASA budget from with the Trump administration budget?
Earth science has taken a hit, but not a horrible one.
Because it would seem to me that he would be completely uninterested in what NASA is discovering.
I would guess that's probably correct. But there's enough sort of shiny objects, you know, the journey to space, that the NASA budget does get protected a little bit. But you're right. The Earth science portion of NASA has taken some hits. EPA is much worse.
Yeah,
in the back.
I've been having some of my students read about ways in which people's political perceptions influence their ways of interpreting and reacting to scientific evidence and expert opinion, both from different sides of the political spectrums. And could you comment on the ways in which multiple conservative perspectives on this coexist and how you perceive people being receptive to or not receptive to the scientific evidence from a conservative part of the political spectrum?
Yeah, I have a good friend whose name is Dr. Bill Patzert. He's been on TV a bunch of times. He's a climatologist at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. Bill's kind of a crusty old guy, and he looked at me and shook his head one day and said, you know, our generation just has to die off. I don't quite agree with him. I think that's a little severe. But yeah, and people view through a lens, which is why I keep looping back to, okay, don't rely on expert opinion. Rely on data. The data are out there in ways that I think anyone can look at it and say there's something going on here. I think that's the only way out of the argument, because if you just offer opinion versus opinion, then it's all about who's got more credibility, and that's just an endless loop that's doesn't have a resolution to it. So I think that I'm not quite answering you directly, but the indirect answer is it's in the data. Keep going back to that. And that's the way you can take fairly disparate opinions. If they can agree that the data are real and not fake, if it's fake news, then all bets are off. But if people are willing to at least say the data are real, then they can use that as a way to get their opinions in some sort of sync. At least that's the only way I see it.
Sea levels, are they going up all around the world?
Yes, they are.
And how much are they going up?
A very small amount right now, because most of the effects are in thermal expansion. For example, the ice that's melting at the poles, it's floating, so it's already in the water. The problem exists with the Greenland and Antarctic ice caps. And North and South Pole operate differently. One, the North Pole is a water body surrounded by land. South Pole is a land body surrounded by water, so they don't work the same way. But these ice shelves in Antarctica act as dams to hold back the glaciers that are on the land. So as they break off a piece the size of Delaware and it floats away, you free up the glaciers that are behind it to move faster. So sea level rise is measurable. And we do this with a variety of tools. Some are sticks stuck in the water. But others are satellites, which can measure down to parts of a millimeter. And they do it by having a very large footprint. So all the little waves and variations go away. But the answer is yes, and it is very likely to accelerate. And the amount, then you start getting away from data and into models. And the models say 10 feet in 100 years, 100 feet in 100 years. It depends on which model you're dealing with.
I've heard many conservatives say that it's just a shift in, this is a warm period we're having, and then sooner there's going to be a colder period we're going to have. Obviously, the chart showed that there was a dramatic spike right now. Is there any evidence, let's say in the next 100 years from now, that's going to dip back down to around normal, or is it going to change downward at any point?
Well, the models say no. And in fact, physics and chemistry probably says no. There's a way to measure what happens with molecules, and it's called a white cell. It's a big tube that you put gases into and then you do stuff to it. Well, long, long ago, a scientist measured the effect of carbon dioxide interacting with sunlight, with energy from the sun. And it simply has to do with physics of the carbon dioxide molecule, that it's very efficient. It's almost a black body. It absorbs and it re-radiates very efficiently. Methane is between 20 and 30 times worse, more radiatively active. So if we do things like melting the methane in the bottom of the Arctic Ocean, or in the taiga in Siberia and in northern Canada, then you get then all bets are off. You can't tell what's going to happen. But it's not going to go down because the physics doesn't work. So I think what you have to do there is say, if carbon dioxide keeps increasing, and it appears to be, then at some point, you know, it's going to be warmer and stay warmer. We had a website as part of the Global Change Data Information System. And in it was a little funny cartoon guy called Dr. Global Change. And there was a thing about Ask Dr. Global Change. And one of the descriptions done very elegantly by a physicist at Columbia was, imagine a bowl and a marble. And if you move the bowl around, the marble kind of moves around, but it always comes back to the middle. Move it too hard, the marble goes out, and then you have no idea. And that's, in modeling terms, that's what's called changing boundary conditions. So there's a complicated answer. But I think the simpler answer is just the physics involved. If we keep increasing CO2, chemistry and physics tell us what's going to happen.
So what, I mean, you gave examples, so what countries are, I guess, most at fault?
The per capita inputs of CO2 for the United States are the highest. But countries like China and India have so many people that the per capita figure isn't really what's controlling. It's all of us, and it's truly a global problem, and it's everything from biomass burning to driving your automobile. It's all of the above. It's a very, very complicated, difficult problem, and that's why people rather not deal with it. Others? Yes?
So how would someone here be able to deal with it or help begin to?
That's a great question. Does somebody have an answer for that? Somebody from the audience? Yeah.
Well, I would say look into some of these solutions and support them. You can buy your solar panels and you can drive your electric car, but unless we have total buy-in to do that, which we wouldn't have unless we had some pretty stringent regulations, individual actions are not going to change things now. Right, and so I think we have to have some large-scale changes by governments to affect change. Did you have something to add?
I was just thinking about the 60s into the 70s, where the United States spent an incredible amount of its resources to put people on the moon. And the spin-off for that, I don't know what the ratio is, but for dollars spent, it's several dollars coming out in terms of generating new ideas, new products for the economy. Isn't that where Velcro came from, something like that? So if we were to put ourselves with the notion that we're going to invest a tremendous amount of our treasure into technologies that are green technologies, really, truly green technologies, then we can start bringing that down and internally generate jobs in the United States. So the notion that I heard on the news, I can't quote exactly, but that the current administration has removed incentives for solar panels seems to me to be counterproductive. What we really want to do is do solar panels in the United States. It's not going to happen great in Wisconsin, but down in the desert southwest, it's certainly a really good thing to do.
Yeah, the two pieces of technology that are needed are increasing the efficiency of photovoltaics and batteries. Mm-hmm. And those are technical things that we could invest in.
It's also a biological solution that I know is going on in certain places down in the desert southwest, and people are trying, companies are investing in growing algae in ponds that produce a lot of oil. So now we're taking, the algae's taking the CO2 out of the atmosphere and we're making oil. It's not like we're taking a fossil carbon out of the ground and burning it. So in a sense, it would be carbon neutral.
Yeah, if you read back in Earth history, you know, the 4 billion years or 4.5 billion years, the role of algae was pretty remarkable, and in fact, that's how we got oxygen.
They invented rust.
And it's the development of oxygen and the development of minerals were kind of an interesting study. Yes, in the back.
I went with my brother to the Grand Canyon a number of years ago, and I couldn't believe in Vegas the lack of solar there. And the answer is that the energy is so cheap from the Hoover Dam that they don't. There's no incentive to go solar in spite of all of the sunlight there. So economics plays a...
Yeah, actually, let me loop to something that's probably not well understood. There are two industry groups or two groups that really get it. One is the military, because they understand that the competition for natural resources is going to create migrations, going to create pressures for between countries. So they get it pretty quickly. And in fact, Nellis Air Force Base won an award for powering most of the base with solar. The other is the insurance agent. companies. They get it. Because as you get more severe events, you don't have to have more of them, you just have to have a few more severe ones. Their losses are huge. But, yeah. Somebody over here? Yes.
I noticed your data from Mauna Loa is in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. Is there corresponding data in the middle of a land mass?
Yeah,
there's
carbon measurements that are done all over the world. When you get to a city, they get really jumbled up. They don't. Mauna Loa has probably the cleanest air on the planet because it's high and it's out in the middle of the ocean. There's a whole lot of reasons why, but it's very, very clean air, which is why those observations are so smooth. Of course, Professor Keeling did it for 50 years. So he had a single methodology, very consistent all the way across. Yeah.
But most of the Earth's population cannot live on that island of paradise, so it's kind of bad for the rest of us.
We actually can measure CO2 with a satellite as well. And you do it with a laser, and you pick an absorption band, and you make a measurement on and off the absorption band, the delta will give you, and it will map it. And there's an actual satellite up that does that. So it's really, we have whole globe looks at where the variability in CO2 is, and there's quite a bit of variability.
So was the Mauna Loa data prior to some of this other technical?
Oh, absolutely. Mauna Loa data, we have 50 years of it. And the satellites have only been around for less than 20.
I was wondering, since water covers most of our Earth, and beneath the water is a lot of green stuff, which contributes to our oxygen, but it also absorbs a lot of CO2 to do what green things do. And I was wondering if the damage to our seas, the ecosystem there, is that reducing the amount of green beneath the water, green that would absorb CO2, as well as give off oxygen in photosynthesis?
Does anybody know the answer to that? Is there a biologist here?
More than one.
The, the CO2 is going to be absorbed by algal photosynthesis, but it's going to be a lot more complex than that, because the CO2 is also dissolving in deep layers. So it's going to go down to a point where there's not enough light to have photosynthesis do any good. So right now we have the CO2 being absorbed at greater rates than we might expect to have in the atmosphere. So there's a lot, and we can model that economically. That's economic. That's just doing a budget sheet for how much fossil fuels are being burned. And it turns out that there should be a lot more in the atmosphere, and where does it go? It's being dissolved into the oceans. The algae will respond to that a little bit, but they're not limited by CO2 in their production, just like corn in a Wisconsin field is not limited by CO2. It's limited by other fertilizers that the farmer might put on his or her land. So once you run out of those other nutrients, you can have all the CO2 in the world, and it's not going to have the algae grow any faster. So they're not going to be a substantial source of sink for the CO2 being produced. Plus, you have pH changes.
Yeah, the pH changes are the, and that's where the biggest sink is the production of carbonic acid. It's a fairly simple equation. And as the oceans acidify, it definitely damages coral. And that's, and in fact, most of the shallow water corals are really in bad shape for a couple of reasons. One is the acidification. The second is actual temperature rise in the ocean that we've measured. And the third is land use practices, which allow sedimentation to cover. Corals are very much endangered. And they form the basis for a lot of the ecosystems that are in the near shore environment. The other, of course, is the estuaries and the aquatic emergence. And so far, the aquatic emergence haven't been affected, except if we get more storms and more severe storms, you'll get chunks of them torn off. And with sea level rise, if it rises too much, then the emergence don't clear the water and start photosynthesis. They have enough in the seed to grow about yay much, and then they have to start getting light and grow the rest of the way. Well, if there's heavy sedimentation or the water gets too deep, the aquatic emergence go away, and that's the rookery for the little fish. Get bigger, 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 bigger. Pretty soon you start losing tuna. Over there in the back.
So, in your opinion, what's the outlook for the EPA under the Trump administration?
It's pretty grim. My friends who are still there, most of them are retiring if they're able. The morale there is horrible. There was a run at the EPA back under President Reagan, when Ann Burford was the administrator, and I was there at that time. And I'm being very frank right now. This is not something that you'll see touted about by talking heads very often. The rank and file civil servants kind of hunkered down, and they couldn't destroy the EPA at that point. And actually, Mrs. Burford turned around quite a bit when she started to see data, you know, and to see the work that was being done by people in EPA, so she actually changed her mind a bit. But it's a fairly dismal climate right now. Mm-hmm.
What is your solution based on, you know, being conservative and a conservationist? How do you see us making something that'll work?
Yeah, I really think the best idea out there is the feed-in dividend, because it's revenue neutral. The money gets taken out, but it gets put back in. So it's not a tax that's used for something else. It goes back into the system. Actually, it has to be all of the above. You know, you can't. There is no silver bullet. And people that think in terms of simple, single solutions to problems, they're not going to come up with something now. It's too complicated. So it needs to be attacked at multiple fronts. But of these sorts of things, we certainly need international agreements. I'll digress just a little bit and tell you a story about the ozone hole, because this is one that a lot of people know about. It's probably one of the best global environmental solutions that has happened. It's certainly one of a handful, but maybe the only one. In the 1980s, there was a real debate in the science community about whether the ozone hole was real or not. It sounds a little familiar to what's going on now, but this was pretty straightforward. The satellites were telling us that there was a hole developing, that there was loss of ozone at the polar regions during the vortex. Okay. People said, no, scientists disagreed all over the place. So finally, NASA sent the U-2 and the DC-8 into the South Polar Vortex in winter. Very dangerous mission for the U-2 guy. One guy, one engine, in a spacesuit. You know, if something happens, he's not coming home. But they collected samples, air samples, at different levels of the atmosphere. The U-2 was up almost 70,000 feet, and the DC-8 was down in the 30s. Brought it back, analyzed it with traditional wet chemistry, and lo and behold, oops, there is an ozone hole. Well, this is running in parallel with the Montreal meeting. The other two pieces of the picture that were good is that we understood the process where chlorinated fluorocarbons would damage the ozone molecule. They were used as propellants, they were used as freon in refrigerators, they were used as solvents. And guess what? There was a commercially viable alternative. So we had a political agreement in the Montreal Protocol. We had real honest-to-goodness wet chemistry measurements, which everybody believed. They reprocessed the satellite data, and lo and behold, the ozone hole was there. The really cool thing is that I've gone on several of the missions from northern Sweden into the north polar vortex. And while I was there, we measured a decrease in the rate of increase, and my colleagues tell me that this year we had a decrease. And that by 2050, we should be probably back to where it was originally. So, but all these things had to line up. We had to understand the physics and the chemistry. We had to have a viable commercial alternative. We had to have a meeting of the minds internationally to ban chlorinated fluorocarbons. And all of those happened, and it worked. Now, fast forward to climate. We don't have those.
But you have laws on the books for bumping up the miles per gallon on cars.
Sure.
And you have a company like Volvo that's going to go electric, mm-hmm. almost totally. Yeah. So there are companies that are stepping up, addressing the problem.
Yeah. Do you folks think that's enough? What about that? Yes.
I was wondering if you have been involved in places like India and China, where they're just simply trying to live like we do and follow that same path, and if they do, it's going to exacerbate the problem. So us doing this may not.
Yeah, and they're saying.
So what's?
Yeah, they're saying you use the ladder, and now you're pulling it up after you.
Yeah, have you been involved in that?
No, not. But I've
at that level, I guess.
But I understand the issue, and it's a severe one. If, in fact, the third world does not go through something called the demographic transition, which is the lower birth rate and a whole lot of other things. If they wait as long as we did to go through it, it'll be too late. Things have to happen differently. On a social science perspective, I think that's what you're getting at.
Yes,
is,
and I was
is
just
the,
wondering, you know,
are those societies
do
prepared to do that? And yeah. And right now,
can we convince that to have that occur in some way using data?
Well, that's the only way that I can see convincing them, because again, opinion doesn't work always. Yes.
Yeah. From what you were saying and the importance of data, I guess I'm looking at the political solution would be to support candidates that are going to increase data collection. I mean, whether you believe things or not. And that doesn't bode well for the conservatives in the current administration. And even in our state with the cuts to the DNR, I'm not a hunter myself, but there I know a number of people that are very concerned about the chronic wasting disease.
Yeah, CWD.
And if we don't get a handle on this, it's really going to hurt the economy and tourism and, you know,
of course it is.
The whole environment.
Of course it is.
With all these deer.
Yeah.
But that was just, I guess the main point would be to support a change that is going to collect more data.
Yeah, there's a group in the Congress that is a climate-related pairing of Republicans and Democrats have to join in pairs, Congressman Gallagher from Wisconsin belongs, and he's certainly conservative enough, so I think we have to just get back to ways in which we work together rather than taking extreme positions on right and left and my way or the highway. That isn't good governance.
Well, denial and ignorance doesn't solve anything.
That's
what data does. I don't know. I totally agree.
And that, to me, that's the conservative approach. Don't go to talking heads. Don't go to opinions. Go look at the data. And they will tell you.
But isn't the funding for data collection disappearing?
Some has. And it's really painful to see that EPA took all of its climate data out of its website. But, again, civil servants, somebody has placed it off to the side and said, well, we're not going to support this any longer, but here's a link if you want to go over there and look. So it still is there. But it's not on the official EPA website. This is dangerous. Remember when I was introduced, I spent a bit of time doing nuclear alert. So I know a little bit about the dangers there. I mean, I've stared at the Russians across the nuclear fence. And my personal view, and this is just a personal opinion, is that the effects of climate change on humanity and on my children and on my grandchildren, for which I have four, every bit is dangerous. Every bit is dangerous. This is not playing games. This is tough stuff. And we need to get about the work. And if you're a conservative, in my view, you want to leave something for your kids that's at least as good as what you experienced. And I think that's a conservative philosophy. I don't.
Who's championing that in Congress? Forget about just Wisconsin.
Well, this group is. This that's where I was
saying
about this pairing between Democrats and Republicans.
What's the group called?
It's the Climate Caucus. And there are 70 or so members now.
Includes
these are House members.
Just House.
Yeah,
just
okay. House. Yeah. And I think that kind of political process is how we get through these problems. we're, those of you that are students, this is going to be in your lap. And your children's lap. It's very serious business. Yes?
Were you a skeptic when talk came about climate change years ago?
In the 1970s, when I was at Wisconsin, there was quite a bit of talk about global cooling. And Reed Bryson was in charge of the Institute for Environmental Studies. He was the principal champion for that theory. And I'm really sure that Dr. Bryson now would say, no, it's warming. But because climate change is, first of all, we didn't have a lot of the measurements. We didn't have the data, okay? Second of all, as you go into a period of climate change, you get a period of instability, up and down and up and down and up and down. And at that point, we didn't know enough. But by the 80s, and certainly by the 90s, we did. And the preponderance of science is toward global warming.
I think it's going to be really interesting to see what happens the next few months in Cape Town, South Africa. And that should be a wake-up call for the rest of the world. Mm-hmm.
Want to elaborate?
It's just a statement.
Hmm? Want to elaborate?
They're going to run out of water, a huge city. And how do they deal with that?
And Arizona hasn't had any rain either. Yes.
I
get back to you.
So I teach environmental studies and ornithology, and your premise here is that we trust the data. How do we argue with how can we convince a small part of the population that doesn't trust, right? So in here we have inherent trust of the data.
Mm-hmm.
I had a student that was telling her about the DDT story, and we were working through an example,
sure,
trying to say authority, whether or not you can trust a research scientist for the EPA, for instance.
I have eagles in my backyard.
And she said no. She said, no, you can't trust that scientist because they may have a political bias. You can't trust the data. You can't trust the data that anyone's produced except the data you produced yourself. So what would your response be to that? Because in here, we're assuming that we look at the data, we trust the data, we trust what the data says, and we can reach a conclusion without fancy modeling that the carbon dioxide levels are going up. And because of general principles, carbon dioxide and as a greenhouse gas, we have warming. But what if you don't trust the data? How do we get past that? Because that seems to be a fundamental problem. For it's not just polarization of science, it's a polarization of what you believe the truth to be. Or not the truth, but there's no common ground then.
And that gets you into a philosophical discussion that's more about religion than anything else. All organized philosophies, or certainly the organized religion, start with, I believe, and then fill in the blank. These are first principles that aren't based on anything except the acceptance of them by themselves. When you get into that kind of a discussion or that kind of a position, I don't think there's much else you can do. I think you just hope that enough people
trust the data.
Get it. Yeah. That's a great question. I have no idea. And you were going to say something.
We're going to take just one last question.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, okay. I think the data is showing that these things are not going to happen anytime soon. So you're talking about the $1 billion infrastructure that's next to the ocean. I mean, I think you have to actually plan for that to go underwater and act accordingly there, or whatever the consequence is, because there's not enough time to fix this and time to fix that. So
and
how do
Puerto
we approach?
Lately?
How do we approach the, using data to say, okay, we have to actually do something because this other thing's not going to happen?
Yeah, actually, I only showed a little snippets. You know, I could have talked for half a day just throwing data out. There's a huge amount of data that are there, and the conclusion that you draw from it is it's not long term. problem being, let me give you one more example. There's a pattern of circulation in the ocean called the thermohaline circulation. It's driven by temperature and salt. Okay, so it loops around all of the oceans, takes about 1,000 years to do that. And there's all kinds of eddies and funny things that happen on the way, but it's kind of a conveyor belt for energy. As it goes past the United States, it's called the Gulf Stream. It gets up near Greenland and Iceland, and it sinks to the bottom and goes all the way back around. Well, Greenland has just under the fifth of the world's fresh water perched as ice. If you melt all of that, you're dumping basically the Great Lakes right at the part of the conveyor belt where it's sinking. Now, fresh water floats on the salt water. If that happens, you get a really abrupt change, and Northern Europe becomes very cold. It'll be like Montreal in London. So despite global warming, it'd be really rapid. The changes that have occurred, if you look at the data in sediments, you find that the big changes in Earth history, being the 4.5 billion year Earth history, ours being just a little tiny sliver. But if you look at the way layers were laid down, things happen pretty fast once they get going. It's not something to put off. And to change things takes time.
Well, why don't we?
One more question.
Yeah, sure.
Just because it relates a little bit locally here, too. Right now, Sheboygan and Ozaukee counties are under non-attainment because they have their air monitoring systems out.
Because of Chicago's air?
And the air comes up. But when they have the air monitor that's now in place over land, it shows consistently that they're under the level of non-attainment, and they're actually, they're underneath the cap. So I'm wondering, do you believe that we need more regulation in general for all the entire country, or do you more or less think we need smarter regulation that can go towards the places that are polluting more?
I think we need better monitoring systems. The ozone monitors, the network isn't dense enough to really give you the kind of information that you need is the correct answer. Now, do we need smart regulation? Of course. And more isn't necessarily, there's a conservative in me that says more isn't great. But you need some. It's part of that constellation that I said, look, you've got to do all of these things in order to solve complex environmental problems. And there's a pattern, air current that's helical that comes up the coast. EPA has known that for quite a while.
But the EPA has known that, but yet Sheboygan County and counties here are being shackled or being strapped down by what's going on in Indiana and Chicago and what is out of control for us. So how much do we allow for our businesses and in our economy to hurt in Wisconsin when someone else or a different state needs to fix that? That's my question.
Well, I guess if you take the blue planet image, you can't see the boundaries. Okay. So ignore the boundaries and say, how do we fix air pollution in the United States, or how do we fix it in the globe? And what sort of monitoring systems do we need to create a dense enough network that we understand truly? Because really, the ozone controls are done by models.
Well, thank you all for coming. We'll give Dr. Thompson.
Once again, happy Valentine's Day.
He will be here for a few more minutes, so if you have a dying question, he can answer it. And if you want some Republican stickers, little goodies over here.